mean, I'm on this way. The first Sunday of the month is a fifth, right? Yeah, we're going to do National Day of Prayer that day. So talk to Stephanie. Oh, so it's all good then. Okay. Okay. That, and I think I was supposed to bring my guitar and play the first song. I did text Stephanie, she didn't respond, but I'm just going to have us do it a cappella. I think so, yeah. I'm just going to have us do it a cappella, just as I am. Yep, we'll just do it a cappella. So. So much on my plate right now. Yeah, I know. I think I got wax on over here. I don't know. All right.
I only love those chimes. I love the way you three play them. It's awesome. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Kettle Moraine United Presbyterian Church. Today is called Good Shepherd Sunday. It happens every year on the fourth Sunday of Easter. And we get to look at Jesus as the? Good Shepherd. Yeah. So we're going to talk about sheep today. But we're going to talk about not just Jesus being the good shepherd, but there might be some others who are good shepherds too. So let your minds play with that as we come closer to our sermon. And we're going to have our story time about shepherd and sheep. So shepherds and sheep are all imagery. Jesus, I don't think, actually ever did any shepherding, although he'd have known a lot about it. Sheep were a big part of the agriculture back in his day. And he refers to us as being sheep. How many of you have wool on you? Well, I'll just put my hand down. It's an image. We have a couple others. So we are like sheep, is what that's getting to. And Jesus is the same as a good shepherd. In fact, I'll go even further. Jesus is such a good shepherd, he makes all the really good shepherds look bad. So we're going to talk about that relationship and what it means for all of us and in this life that we live in the here and now. Because I will tell you, I'm going through the news right now. Ooh, we could use some good shepherding. This world really needs that. And so we'll have some fun with that. With that being said, let us pray in our offerings with our offertory prayer together. Please pray with me. God of love, you abide with us. You provide for our needs and guide us in your ways. Out of gratitude for your care, we bring our gifts before you. Use them for your work of caring, that all may feast at the table of abundance, walk without fear, and drink deeply from the cup of compassion. Amen. Let us sing together our doxology.
Gathering hymn is Just As I Am. It's found in the red hymnal, number 119. 119. We'll sing verses 1, 4, and 5. 1, 4, and 5.
Thank you.
seated. I invite our youth to come forward for our story time.
Good morning, y'all. How are you guys doing? Good. Are you feeling better?
Good. I was so worried about you. Your mom told me, yeah. Your mom told me that you might need some prayers, so I definitely was keeping you in my prayers.
Today is Good Shepherd Sunday, and what do you think Good Shepherd Sunday might be all about? The shepherd and the sheep. So I think sheep are kind of cute myself. How about you guys?
Yeah. But they're kind of funny, too, at the same time, aren't they? Yeah.
Now, if you were to see all those sheep right in front of you, or even on the screen, do they all look the same? Kinda, yeah. Yeah, Laura likes naming the chickens next door, and they're easy to tell apart because they look different. But I think she'd have a hard time distinguishing which sheep have which name, because they all look a lot alike. And yet, some of them have little personalities that make them stick out, like this one, right? Yeah. So, shepherd and sheep, yeah, they're kind of funny. What do you know about sheep? Do you know anything about sheep? They're fluffy, yeah! You know anything else about sheep? When I was in Montana, I was a pastor in Montana, and I'll tell you something, I actually got to work with sheep. One of the ranchers out there was a sheep rancher. And it's hard kind of intermixing with them because ranchers are always busy doing their ranching, right? Because they said that even if you come by your house, they're probably at least fixing fences. We're never home. I'm like, oh, well, that's kind of makes things difficult. So I said, well, can I help you on your ranch? And then we can kind of get to know each other that way. And they're like, yeah, sure. So I was helped and I branded sheep. Don't worry, they use paint for branding sheep. So this one was green paint. I think I used branding them with the number 4. And they do that so if the sheep get away and another rancher finds them, they say, oh, that's not one of mine, that's number 4. It belongs to the Salzmans or to the Jorgensens or to the whomever. And so they get their sheep back to where they're supposed to go. I helped lamb. I helped dock the sheep. We won't go into that one. One thing I learned about the sheep, though, from the ranchers, is they don't see very well. Did you know that? Sheep have a hard time seeing. And so they will look at you and you'll be all fuzzy and whatever else. And unless you really are small or whatever, you know, different from the size of the shepherd, because they trust the shepherd. Sheep just, they know their shepherd and they trust their shepherd. But they don't trust anybody else because it's kind of dangerous because they don't know what that person's up to. And so since they can't see very well, what do you think they do to be able to tell the shepherd from everyone else? Hear, yeah. Sheep listen to the voice. And I thought, oh my goodness, Jesus talks about that. When the sheep hear my voice, they will follow me. But when they hear the voice of strangers, they won't. And I've got lots of funny stories I can tell you after church if you want to hear about me trying to shepherd those sheep, because that's one of the jobs I had to do. They didn't listen to me at all. We don't know you. But when Larry Drain would come in to deal with them, boy, he could get them to move all over the place because they knew his voice. Pretty crazy, huh? Well, do you think Jesus calling himself the Good Shepherd today and calling us sheep, do you think he's really only concerned about sheep like these? What do you think he means when he's talking about sheep? What do they be an image of? You are good! Yeah! He refers to himself as the Good Shepherd and refers to us as people. Now, all the sheep looked about the same. What about these people? Do they all look the same? No. Some are older, right? Some are younger. Some have different skin tones, right? There's both male and female in there, right? In fact, the more you look at them, they're all kind of different. They dress different.
And you think Jesus loves all the people or just some of them?
All of them, yeah.
That's kind of difficult because sometimes there's some people we don't like. That's just kind of, that happens. But do you think Jesus still likes them? And he says, yeah, come be a part of the fold. Come be one of my people. And sometimes that's kind of hard for us because what if those people that we don't like come to our church because they're part of the fold? And what if they sit right next to us? Oh my goodness. That's even harder, isn't it? But here's the thing. If Jesus loves them all, and if they're not like, Jesus says that we're going to only love some, what if we become ones that Jesus doesn't like? So if Jesus loves everybody, that includes you too, doesn't it? And that makes life better. We know that Jesus loves each of us because Jesus loves all people, everyone, all of us. And he wants us to take care of each other, and he comes to take care of us, all of us. And no matter what happens in life, Jesus always loves you and will always care for you and will always come to make your life better. And that's the best news about being a sheep, whether you're fluffy or not. Let us pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for promising to care for us always and to be our shepherd. Help us to see each other as loved and cared for by you, and help us to care for everyone as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for coming up. Have fun in Sunday school. Let us enter into our confession with a call to confession. We wander from hope to hope, thinking the next person, the next book, the next new thing will lead us in the ways in which we long to live. Yet if we open our eyes and pay attention, we will see the Good Shepherd, the one who will bring us into the kingdom of God's mercy, God's hope. And so even as we confess all the foolish mistakes we've done and all the wrong turns we have made, we know the Good Shepherd is right there with us, loving us all the way. Please join me as we pray, saying, you long to fill us with your comfort and peace, God of grace. But we continue to take on more anxiety, more worry, more fear. You would comfort us in the gentleness of your hope. But we welcome and embrace a world spinning more and more out of control. You would feed us with more than we need. But we continue to hunger for sweet sensations offered to us by temptation. You keep your promises and offer us forgiveness and mercy all the days of our life. May we keep our eyes focused on the path you have shaped for us. And may we listen to the call of the Good Shepherd who leads us into your joy, that kingdom prepared for us by Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Let us take some time for self-examination, reflection, and confession. People of God, this is the good news. Wherever we are, God is with us. Whoever we are, God forgives us and gives us new life. Surely goodness and mercy are the companions we have been longing for, faithful friends, as we continue our journey as God's people. Amen. Let us confess our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. I want to welcome and invite up Stephanie and Gretchen for our special music, The Gift of Love.
Scripture, we are party to your living word who walked among us, and we are surrounded by your spirit who whispers words within our hearts and minds. Inspire us in our hearing and reflecting that we may move beyond your words into life-changing acts of grace, love, hope, and peace. Amen. Our first scripture reading comes from 1 John chapter 3. Hear God's word spoken to you. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's good and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth, and we will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Judy. Gotta tell you, one of my favorite epistles is 1 John. So as you read it, lightens my heart, takes me deeper, makes me feel more spiritually connected to self and the world that God has made. John 10 plays in very similar ways for us today, and let us hear that as Jesus talks about the Good Shepherd and what it means to be the Good Shepherd. Our reading comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 10. Hear now God's word spoken for you. Jesus says, "I am the Good Shepherd, and the Good Shepherd lays his life down for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd, does not own the sheep, and sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. The wolf snatches them and scatters them. Hired hand runs away because the hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the Good Shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, I laid down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also so that they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock and one shepherd. And for this reason, the Father loves me, because I've laid down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I've received this command from my Father." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be
to God. Oh, that's pretty serious and heavy stuff, right? I am the Good Shepherd, and I lay down my life for the sheep. So, the Good Shepherd, who do we accredit that to? Please answer that for me. Jesus, usually, right? And he kind of labels that himself, "I am the Good Shepherd," and I can't deny that. What does it mean for Jesus to lay down his life for the sheep? What brings that to? His crucifixion, yeah. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, laying down his life for the sheep. Jesus, being crucified on the cross, loving us so much that he's willing to die. When Jesus said this, it really echoes back to what we read in John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever may believe in him will have eternal life." And then 17, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but all the world might be saved through him." That too is deep and powerful stuff. And if you were to map it, if you were to draw this out, it would look kind of like this, a downward arrow, God serving the world. Right? God coming down and serving the world. And the theology around that, I can't argue that. It's very good, but I always ask, is there more to it than simply God coming and serving us? God coming and helping us? God coming and rescuing us? God coming, and it's always God, only God, doing that kind of stuff. But we're going to talk about that. Because maybe there's a little bit more dynamic in the theology than just that.
See, our theology is Reformed Presbyterians is not just God coming down, but also us going out. Well, arrows going out as well, right? So we don't just sit there and come to church and say, oh, that was a nice sermon. I like that. Well, I check that off my box and then go back to life as usual. That's not how it works. God comes, and when he comes down and meets us where we're at, there's a little intersection right there between you and God. God transforms your life into the image of who? Yeah, God, Jesus. And being transformed, you're no longer who you once were. But now, you're like Jesus so much that you live a life like Jesus, right? And so you're sent out in the world not as what you used to be, but as God wants you to be and made you to be in the here and now. Now, that doesn't mean that we're not going to be teachers anymore because that's who we used to be, or we're not going to be pastors anymore because that's who we used to be, or we're not going to be veterinarians anymore because that's who we used to be. No, it means how you are a teacher, how you are a pastor, how you are a veterinarian. And that's what Jesus is getting at today. And that's what our epistle is getting back at today. Judy, I got to thank you because I love that part you read today. It was just gorgeous. Did you catch it? When Judy read, we know love by this, that he laid his life down for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for each other. Wow. Yes, Jesus lays his life down for you, but that transforms you to be like Jesus so that you love others by laying down your life for them. Now, if you get really worried that you're going to be hung on the cross too, don't worry about that. That's not what we're talking about here. Yeah, Hebrews tells us that Jesus was the last sacrifice. But Jesus did more than just love us by the cross, right? The cross just shows us the extreme Jesus will go to love us. Rather, loving others is about taking care of others, helping others, nurturing others. I think it's time for a little bit of a story. Imagine you see a good friend who, maybe fell down and they can't get up. We'll just keep it simple, playing off an old commercial. And you stand there and you say, I really love you. Oh, I love you so much. You have no idea how much I love you. Oh, and the person's trying to get up, they can't, and you just keep saying, oh, I love you so very, very much. I love you from the bottom of my heart. Isn't that wonderful? I love you that much? I see some giggles out there. It's really a silly situation because does that person need to hear that you love them? Or do they need the act of loving them? Now, if you see someone falling down, call 911 because they might be a broken bone or something else that you can't assess. But the point is, when you see someone in need, we are to just say, oh, I love you so much. Or are we to help them in their need? God calls for us to help them. In fact, it's kind of interesting because the word love in Scripture is really not so much a romantic feeling. It's not chocolates or whispering sweet nothings. That's the American version of love. In Scripture, it's an act of love. It's doing something that will help those who are in need. That's what love means in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. It's an action. An action for those who are in need. And so when you're just saying, I love you, you should also follow up by saying, can I help? What do you need? How can I be there for you? What can I do to make things better? Does that make sense? That's what our reading is really about. You see, the good shepherd didn't say, hey, I'm the good shepherd and I love all my sheep and yeah, that's good enough. No, Jesus took it to an action. I am the good shepherd, and I've laid down my life for the sheep. I will do for you, even to my life's end. You ever hear of a, oh, I love you to death? What does that mean? Oftentimes, it's sort of an image of, I love you and I'll hold nothing back. Oftentimes, it's a phrase to say it's a deep, deep love. I am very emotionally connected to you. But have you ever thought of it literally? I love you to death. I think we come close to that. But there is one who I know goes to that. That's Jesus. He literally loves us even to death, even death on the cross, St. Paul points out to us. That is the extent Jesus will go. There is no place in our lives we can now go, for Jesus has always already been there, even to the point of dying on the cross, the most torturous and humiliating way to die. There is nothing and nowhere you can be where Jesus hasn't already gone. And he's not afraid of going back there either for you. You cannot escape Christ's love. And that makes a difference in our lives, doesn't it? Think about a time when someone did something really, really good for you, helped you out. It could have been something small. But you're stuck. Couldn't do anything, and next thing you know, someone showed up, did whatever, and it made all the difference in the world. I'm just getting a flood of stuff coming through my mind. God goes even further than that. Remember how that kind of transformed you a little bit? Remember how they'd say, hey, you know what? That really meant something. I'm going to help that person back. God's love touches us and says, don't do something back for me, or if you are, I want you to do, the thing I want you to do back for me is to help all others out who are in need. Jesus literally sends us out into the world, having experienced that deep and abiding love, that extreme love, that love with no boundaries, no barriers, holding nothing back, fills us up to overflowing, and sends us out not to focus our lives on just me and God in the world, but as Judy read, that we ought to lay down our lives, we ought to share that kind of love for the lives of one another. When's the last time you watched the news? Last night? How's the world doing right now? And see, that's the kind of problem I have with the, oh, it's just between God and me. Because if you watch the news and everybody just say, oh, it's just me and my God, oh, I love God so much. God is so good. Thank you, God. Thank you. I'll do whatever you got, whatever. I'm focused on you, oh God. I'm just going to focus on you because I know that you love me. What happens to the rest of the world that God made? We are always looking up, just having a relationship with God, and not focusing on having a relationship with others. Good things don't happen in the world that way, people. That's why we ought to love others, as God has so loved us. And if you think about it, if we are made into little Christs, aren't we also made into little shepherds? Did you know that the word Christian literally means little Christ? So we're shepherdings, little shepherds as well. And our love for God pours into us so that we can then be there for the world. And hopefully we'll touch another person's life so they don't end up on the news. That's good news, is it not? Let's go back a second, because we talked about careers. Let's go back a second even further. We'll tie it into Scripture. Jesus differentiates his life and how he lives his life from the hired hand, right? Now, on the surface, it looks about the same. The hired hand is hired to go in there and take care of the sheep, right? And it's shepherd goes in there and the shepherd takes care of the sheep. They look pretty similar, correct? Both situations, sheep are cared for more or less similar until the wolf shows up. When the wolf that can hurt the hired hand and the sheep shows up, what does the hired hand do? Runs away. When tragedy and trauma comes up in the world, what is it we often instinctively in our human instincts want to do? Run away. What does a good shepherd do? Sticks to it. Sticks with it. Does not run away, but continues to herd and keep the sheep together so the wolf does not damage the sheep, even to the point of having to lay down his life for the sheep. See, this is the defining difference between the good shepherd and we as good shepherds and the rest of the hired hands of the world. Hired hands are in it for themselves. They're getting paid. They're going out there and they're doing their job until their job asks too much of them. And they're like, yeah, I'll see you. I'm out of here. The good shepherd is in it for the sheep, not for himself. And he cares for and loves and abides and sticks with because his focus is not on self, but on the other. And so, if you're a teacher, be a teacher for the other. Not just to collect a paycheck, be a teacher for the other. If you're a veterinarian, be a veterinarian for those dear, sweet animals. You're cute and, well, sometimes you may say that's not cute, but be there for them too. If you're a pastor, be there for your sheep. People, I love you. Not just to say, I love you so much, I'm so sorry you're going through all that, but yeah, I'm out of here. I can't endure that. Been here 8 years now, people. And we've been through a lot in 8 years. I'm still here because I love you with a deep and abiding love. In fact, I still have a sliver in my finger from some of the work I was doing on the chest. Be there for the other. That's what it means. You're still you, but you're you in a whole new way. The epistle says that, does God love abide in anyone who sees the world in need, their brothers and sisters in need of help, and not do anything? Nope. And so hear me clearly now. You've been baptized. You've been made one with Christ. You are now little shepherds. Go and live it. And as you do so, I want you to never, ever, ever forget this. And if you do, come talk to me, I'll remind you of it. Not only are you not the good shepherd, you're just in the image of the good shepherd, but when you mess up, that good shepherd love will never leave you. It comes back over and over with love, mercy, kindness, forgiveness. Brushes you down and says, everybody messes up. Go back out there and keep sharing that love. Forgiveness takes all our mistakes away. It makes us, it renews us, it keeps us alive in Christ Jesus. And that comes in that love. Mercy does the same thing. We have a good shepherd that will never, ever, ever leave our side, right? So don't worry about the mistakes you might do. Don't worry about the mistakes you might have done. All Jesus says is, live it. And when you see someone who needs some love, love them. Do the thing for them. And know this, that you don't even have to do the work on the backside of it. Just love them. And then go on and love someone else. God will take what you have done, and God's Spirit will enter deep into their heart and into their soul and into their lives. And God will do that transformative work on the backside. The pressure's really off. In the end, this is kind of the offertory of our lives. Just as we give our financial offerings back there, we now give our lives to the Good Shepherd, saying, yeah, I'm part of a good fold now. I don't have to worry, I don't have to be anxious. I'm a part of Jesus' fold. For he is my good shepherd, and he cares for all of my needs. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Even in the midst of the valley of death, I don't have to fear any evil, because he's with me. And God's rod and staff, they will comfort me. Oh, goodness. God will take care of me through all the days of my life, and I will reside in the house of the Lord forever. You know what? That's the kind of shepherd I think I'll follow. Amen. Let us stand as we are able for this song. It's in our red hymnal, number 183, Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us, 183. And we'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4. 1, 3, and 4. Let us stand as we are able. Shall not be in want. Your creative grace is visible in lush green pastures and revealed in still clear waters. Your restoring, resurrecting spirit revives our souls and in our communities. And you guide us in ways of righteousness for the sake of the earth. We pray for the earth you create and love, for people, families, nations, species that dwell in the valley of the shadow of death, For all who fear the evils, pollution, violence, depredation, and illness. For those suffering in our hearts this morning, and for those whom we will never meet. At this time, we especially pray for those in our prayer list, O Lord. John and Janine, Nance and Rebecca, John, Tom, Carol, Sarah, Judy, Lori, Jennifer, Denise, Doreen, John and Paulette, Tyler and Judith, Dory and Ashley. For all those who are affected by the wars in Israel and Gaza and in Ukraine. The crisis in Haiti, the victims of the Baltimore bridge collapse, and the victims of the earthquake in Taiwan. We also lift up Patty and Tim and Victoria and Lee, and the family of Scott Campbell, who passed on March 14th. At this time, O Lord, we lift up all those who are in our hearts, whether we do so now with voice or silently. Andy and Kathy.
Mark.
Judy and Gary.
And Mary.
Bonnie.
Debbie's family.
Charlie.
Shepherding God, be with your people. With your rod and your staff, restore us and lead us. Spread your table of abundance before those who hunger and thirst. Set us free from enmity and division. Anoint us with your calling of reconciliation. Let the cup of our life overflow with justice for all of your creation. Let your goodness and mercy follow us all the days of our life. Make this earth your home forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us follow that prayer with the Lord's Prayer, whom Jesus himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Do we have a minute for mission? So we'll just focus on the compost container unit. It's a little further, isn't it? Did you notice there's a door on it now? The other door should be on it this afternoon. And did you notice that there's some shingles on the front of it, too? They're all kind of the same color, so it's kind of hard to differentiate. Trust me, when it ages, it will look even better. Our Boy Scout and our future Eagle Scout and family and myself, we've all been working on that. How does it look, by the way, so far? You like it? Awesome. We're going to hopefully get it finished up, and then I'm going to put some nice little aesthetics on there. I'm going to put a cross, which is more than aesthetic, but a visual reminder of what this is all about. That we're taking food that is considered, well, pretty much dead. We've eaten it, and this is the leftovers, right? And normally that just gets tossed away. No, we're going to resurrect that food by turning it into wonderful, delicious compost. At session, we talked about this a little bit. And it sounds like we're going to have more people helping do the composting. Praise be to God. Because it's hard to do too many things, if you can probably have already experienced in your life. So the more people who help with this. But at the very minimum, that unit will have buckets behind those doors. And it will have lids behind those doors. And we're going to have between 1 gallon buckets and 5 gallon buckets, depending on how fast your family eats food, or how many people are eating food, and you take a bucket that would accompany. Take it home. On the lid will be printed out what should go in the bucket, and there's another list that says, do not put this in the bucket. This does not belong in compost. Just put the stuff that belongs in there. Take it and put it on the bottom shelf, which is open and exposed, and then we will then go forward trying to figure out some sort of way for someone. Myself will be probably involved with this, but I found someone in the congregation who is very good at composting, Judy McBroom, so she will probably be guiding that portion of how we're going to do the compost bin. But by bottom line, when we see a bucket on that bottom shelf, it's open for a reason. We'll grab it, dump it in, mix it in with whatever we need to mix it in with to make it start composting well, doing good heat composting. And so when you drop your bucket off, just grab a new one and go home and continue filling. Try to keep your portion as simple as possible and realize that you're not now filling landfills. Your compost will be helping with a garden that'll grow vegetable and will fill the hungry in our food desert areas, places where it's not, you have to go quite a distance to get good food for yourself. So instead of filling a landfill, you're now filling lives. And that's good shepherding right there, people. Any thoughts or questions on that? So it won't be staying in my driveway forever, or the church driveway forever. We're going to be moving it, I think on the approach, probably on the other side of the driveway where the neighbor is. We'll just have that. We own that property too, and I talked to the neighbor already. So most likely be over there. Don't hold me to it. But if you want to start getting a vision of where it's going to be put, so all you got to do is drive in, drop it off, and then whip around and on your way. Wonderful. How about any announcements from those gathered? I've got a couple. We're going to, on May 5th, our worship service will be in honor of National Day of Prayer. So I heard that that's actually going to be quite fun and interactive. So come and join us for National Day of Prayer, and we will get to experience prayer in a number of different types of ways. May 12th is Mother's Day. The fun thing about that is our three youth are going to get Bibles that day. So we made that decision as well. So come celebrate Mother's Day and celebrate those incredibly fun and wonderful and talented girls growing in Christ as they receive their Bibles as well. There's a lunch and worship on May 5th, so bring your appetites. We'll have a little luncheon. And last day of Sunday school is May 5th as well. And so we will send them, wrapping up Sunday school, send them on their way with Bibles. Food for the journey. The garden is getting up and running. You may have noticed there is a tarp that is covering up a big lump of soil underneath. We need to put more soil in the garden. We're going to do that this Tuesday, I think at around noon. If you're able to come and help, we're also going to pull some weeds out. So please, yeah, show up Tuesday and help us get that around noon and help us get that going and get the beds ready for our new vegetables that we'll be growing this year. So that is that for now, except for one other thing. I got this from Phyllis. Lord of Life Lutheran Church, I will put this on the table where the bulletins are, so if you want to take a look at it yourself. But this coming Sunday, 1 week from today,